nowadays, I mean, women have to fend for themselves. I mean, they have to live or have the mind frame to be independent. Women have to be the go-getter, the money maker, breadwinner. In the traditional way, a man is supposed to go out and make the money while the woman, you know, stay at home, take care of the kids, take care of the house. But we can't find men like that these days. So the woman have to do it. The woman got to go out, make the money, buy the groceries, cook, take care of the kids, and take care of the man. They want to stay at home, play the game all day, work part-time with two kids. You know, you can't find a black man or, you know, a black man that really has his head on straight. I mean, you can't find men like the way they used to be, those traditional men. You can't find that. I mean, those numbers show, statistics show. You know, a woman probably would rather be single than to deal with men like that. It's like men don't have that drive these days. We can't find them with that drive, you know, to actually get out and do something with themselves. You have to push men more. Well, women just get up and go do it.
I didn't meet my dad until I was 18, but my mama never told dad shit. Your dad did. Yo, we wasn't discussing. There's no reason to discuss. Mm-hmm. Either good or bad. I had everything I needed. When he decided he wanted to be a part of my life, okay, we cool. It is what it is. You could have stayed where you wanted, where you was at if you wanted to, but you know, I'm glad you made the decision and all that.
Did you know that statistics say that 70% of black women are single and 42% of them are unwed mothers? Single parents are facing many difficulties, financial burdens, dealing with the father of their children, and not to mention being the primary caregiver for that child. We're not thinking about the effects that being raised in a single parent home, that it has on our community, our children, and our race as a whole. I'm Dorothy Lucy, and I'm here to tell you, my brothers and sisters of all races, that the concept of open legs with a closed mind is no longer acceptable.
Becoming a single parent to me was difficult in a lot of ways. I was actually a virgin until I was 24 years old. My faith is important to me. I got saved when I was 13 years old, and I really had a really close relationship with the Lord. And just finding out I was pregnant, all of that was just generally devastating to me in a lot of the ways. Because you know, I maintained my virginity as long as I did. I finished grad, you know, I was in a really low place after going through some financial hardship, having a car repossessed and being evicted and all these different things, and trying to help out a family member, all those things like that. And then right in that low place where I was emotionally, financially, I met somebody who I feel like was really just a vulture and took advantage of that place where I was in my life. And, you know, not much longer after that, I conceived my daughter. And so it was really hard for me, knowing the closeness I've walked with the Lord and the relationship I've had with the Lord and the intimacy I had with God, to be in that place and then be in that position by my own fault. I actually was just really devastated. And when I thought about my life, I thought about, you know, ministries I've done and college campuses, how I've prayed and fasted, and, you know, the fact that, I mean, I passed by all the football players and basketball players, the dual degree candidate, the PhD candidate, the doctor, you know, all these people that, you know, these men that I never succumbed to, I never engaged with. I really actually had a hard time with contemplating suicide when I was pregnant. I thought, you know, I'll just walk in front of an 18-wheeler and, you know, just end this and just go on home because this is so painful. And so at the point that I had my daughter, I had spent over 15 months being celibate, trying to get back on the track of living a life that was pure before the Lord. And it was difficult in a lot of ways. I did a lot of soul searching after that happened because I thought to myself, I never, ever want to be here again. And certainly don't want to take my child here, you know, in this place with me. So I spent the majority of my pregnancy really looking through different decisions I made and different emotional states I was in. And at this point where I wasn't as close to God, I was doing this. And when I was really close to God, I was doing that. And just all these things to figure out how I got there so I wouldn't be in that same place again. So it was really, really difficult. I made an appointment to an abortion clinic the day after I found out I was pregnant, something I thought I'd never do past the age of 19. It was a very hard time for me emotionally.
A black woman have to be strong is they're at a disadvantage coming forward into life. Basically, you know, it's not the same advantage as you know, a white woman is bred or, you know, Asian, whomever. I just feel like it's harder for a black woman to, you know, be positive in a society that we have now. So, you know, with you see all these shows like, you know, Atlanta's Housewives, and they blow up the drama. Not all black women go through that, you know. There are some hard working, you know, strong, intelligent black women that hold a household down, you know, single, two kids, three kids. However, that's just, you know, It's just funny that that's how they're based out. That's how their life is, and it's not right.
I am very bitter because, I mean, everything that I'm saying, I've experienced that myself with my child's father. I mean, the financial burdens. I mean, the majority of that is because of him, because I have to take care of his part in mine. Daycare, I have to pay that. Gas to take her there, I provide that. Food, clothes, I provide all that.
I have basically 23 kids. By 15 baby moms. They're all black, but there might be more possibilities out there. That's real talk, for real, I'm not lying. So if you see me, you recognize me, Devon Reese, Facebook me. Just get in contact with me.
The black community is suffering, and it's time for a wake-up call. The true leaders of yesterday have faded away. Dr. King, Malcolm X, have we completely done away with marrying the mother of our children, leaving our communities, marrying outside our race because we make up a substantial amount of income? Have we completely forgot the importance of family?
White women are, they're loyal. They are loyal.
I went to somebody different as, like, different culture, meaning, like, they experience more. I mean, I'm not saying that a black person can't be, like, cultural, like, doing stuff different, but I just feel like I'm black, I kind of know what we're going to do. Like, if you date outside your race, it's like, they've done more or they've done something different. Or I'm pretty sure they grew up differently from me.
After jail and drugs and what else, something else was missing, all those few good black men that we have left, you white woman come and steal them. Hold up, sweetheart.
I heard that.
Hold up. First of all, I don't steal nothing. Second of all, if somebody likes me, then they like me. If they like me because I'm white, oh, trust me, I can weed it out.
Black women are not the only ones that wear weave, hair extensions. There's a lot of Caucasians, Asians, Spanish women that wear hair extensions, clip-ins. I think people think that it's just a black thing, but it's really not. You know, just working in my field, you see it on a day-to-day basis. White women come to get extensions, clip-ins, infusions for the length of their hair or to add, you know, volume or thickness to their hair as well. It's not just a black thing, it's just a woman's thing. It's hard to find a great black man nowadays for a single black woman. I feel like the black men are more so into anything other than black women.
I think it's sad that we as African-American females will not educate ourselves to understand that we're not machines just spitting out babies. We're human, we have our feelings, and at the end of the day, that's all we have. So if my feel good is enough for you to feel like I can be your baby mama, why is it not enough for you to wife me? I do everything you need me to do. I do everything you want me to do, but at the same time, you don't want to be labeled as my husband. It's ridiculous. We got to get better.
The reason why I made the choice not to get married, it was fear. I was young, I was 24, I was responsible for another life. My life totally changed. I mean, here it was, I was looking at a baby that now, anything that I did, that it could harm his future. You know how we do things that we just don't consider. Speeding without a seatbelt on. Unprotected sex. I mean, doing anything that's illegal. I mean, the people that I associated myself with. You know, I had did a lot of different things, and by the grace of God, I was still here. I became a parent, became a father. So there was a lot of things that just totally changed in my life. I had ran my run, doing things that now, as a result, he could become fatherless. As a result, his father could be incarcerated. Me and mom were in two different states. I was flying back and forth to see my child. And I learned that just because two people have a child, you don't have equal custody. I wanted that responsibility. You know, I went to court, I had to get documents, I had to do a lot of work. You know, it took time, it took money, it took going back and forth to court, and I finally got custody of my son. Was I afraid? Yeah. Did I have to, you know, have mom help me? Yeah. Because I didn't know. I didn't know how to raise a kid. But when I say it was by choice, I took on that responsibility. I wanted my son. Now, in reference to why didn't I marry her, I was just afraid. I didn't even consider marriage. And my parents never said to me, hey Vince, you know what, you should marry her. You have a child, you're responsible for this child, whether the child's gonna be with you or not. That is your responsibility, it will be your responsibility for the rest of your life. That I understood, that became real clear to me.
I think it's the most paramount decision that you can make when you become a parent is to spend as much time as possible with your son, daughter, to ensure that you teach them good values and you bring them up right, because the world is a pretty cruel place, and you know, there's not a lot of room for error once you grow up. So I think being a parent is the most important job in the world.
The family is so important in raising children and how they are successful in life, and it's their basis. It's where they need to go. You need to have the family dinner table discussions. You need to at least see face to face, even if they're not really sharing with you, you can tell.
Black men are not raising their children because they're not in the household. The reason is they're not in the household is because generational. You know, for the last 20 years, they're growing up without fathers in their families, and they see this and think that it's acceptable.
Whenever you don't have a father in your life, or a father principle in your life, because it don't have to be your actual father, but a father principle in your life, you're gonna lack the identity, which ties to everything in your life, especially as a male. Because how do you have your self-esteem? How do you have your self-confidence if you have no beginning in which you began, if you can't do that? For me, my father left me, I would say, all my life, basically. That's how I feel. Now, in that, I always search for where do I belong? How do I fit in? Now, the danger in that lack of identity is I'm going to grab something that gives me identity. All right, so whether it's football, whether it's basketball, whether it's music, whether it's church. Now, in that, it may give me identity, but it's all false. And the reason why I say it's false is because the minute I can't do that, I go back to the same longing that I had as if I'm still nobody. So now I become addicted to my very gift, and I use my gift as a covering, not as a tool in life, because I don't know my identity. So I say this, I'm a football player. Well, what happens when you can't play? Or you're a musician, what happens when you can't play? I'm a preacher, what happens when you can't preach? Or I'm a good looking guy, you gain 400 pounds, you gain 30 pounds. Or I've always been able to talk to women, what happens when you don't have your language? Or you meet a woman who's not impressed with that? You go back to that longing. And most men don't know who they are without anything. What I mean by that, scratch everything that you do, everything that makes you feel good, and do you feel good by yourself? Just because of where you belong. Now, not to be so spiritual, but it goes back to when Jesus was being baptized. He said, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. The reason why he said it was Jesus had did nothing. I want you to know that I am pleased with you just because you're my son. You have to have that identity. If you don't have that identity, you'll always have to do something to believe you are something. And who you are is not what you do. But we believe that. So we mess up as men. So we fall into titles, as I had a friend of mine, never had a father in his life. He was raised up poor, got molested. So he said, I'm gonna prove that I'm a man. I don't know if I'm a man. So I'm never gonna be poor. So he started selling drugs. I'm always gonna have the best of clothes on. He always had to have on Nike, FUBU, whatever the top things was, he had to have them on because that was his identity. And he would go through any measure to get that because he knew without that, I may be nothing, or I may be the child that's been molested. I may be the gay guy. I may be the guy who's dumb and stupid. And his identity came from what he did, not for who he is. And most men suffer from that, and that bleeds into everything. Why they gotta have sex so much, why they gotta have certain women around them all the time, they gotta have the best of jobs. The minute they get around other men, what do, man? And you gotta prove what you do. You gotta bodybuild, you gotta lift weights, you gotta get your look together because you don't know who you are. And that's why you can't expose yourself. Most men won't deal with their emotions, how they really feel, how that woman really broke their heart, how they not happy with life. Because if they go back to that place, they gotta go back to, I'm probably nothing because I don't have any identity. But when you know who you are from a father who says, I'm pleased with you, not because you play, not because you sing, not because you preach, not because I bought you Jordan, but because you're my son. The identity come from the sonship. Then you say, I'm somebody whether I never have anything. There's a proven fact that if Bill Gates would lose all his money today, he'll be rich tomorrow. Not because of what he did, but because of how he thinks about himself. See, so when you be rich from within, you can always be rich from without. Most men are poor from within. So they grab riches to make them feel like they're rich because they don't believe they're rich with nothing. But when you know you're a diamond, whether you are in the mud or not, I'm a diamond. If I'm worth $3.5 billion, it don't matter where you place me. In a closet, in the mud, in the water, I'm still $3.5 billion because I'm a diamond. Most men don't know that. So, and that comes from not having that father piece, and it bleeds into everything, and we're lost, and we don't even know how to talk about it and deal with it. So when we get around real men, it makes us intimidated. So if you get around a real man who can talk just as much as you, all of a sudden you gotta prove who's the bigger man. See what I'm saying? You got to go through that because your identity can't stand alone. But when you have that father, that identity, that principle that says you are somebody just because of what you come from. Now I'll use a natural example, Coming to America, one of my favorite movies. Eddie Murphy didn't mind where he lived. It didn't mind if he lived in a ghetto, it didn't mind if they stole this stuff, because he kept saying, it don't matter, I'm a son of a Munda. I knew who I am, I'm a son of a Munda. I'm a king's kid, so it don't matter where we live. They can have this stuff. So what, we work at McDonald's, because I know who I am. Simeon was a servant, he was nervous. He needed to have a nice room, go get some money, go get some clothes, want a better job, because he didn't know who he was. But Eddie Murphy understood, it don't matter, I'm a son of a Munda. When you have that identity, it don't matter where you go. I am rich in the ghetto. I am rich without a wife, without a woman. I am rich if I'm walking, catching the bus, because I know who I am. When you get that identity from a father or the principle of a father, you can survive in any environment and rise to the top, because kingship is from within, not from without. If you ain't crowned on the inside, the crown on the outside is your cover up.
I grew up in a single parent home where I yearned for that relationship with my father. And although he was there, he was so far distant. He lived in Michigan, I lived in Texas, that I wasn't able to engage in that relationship. And I wanted that. And I wanted that. And I wanted that.
In the school year 1999 and 2000, 71,000 black women achieved bachelor's degrees, while only 37,000 of the black male counterparts achieved the same. In the school year 2009-2010, we had 109,000 black women to achieve bachelor's degrees, and only 56,000 of the black male counterparts achieved theirs. Why are black men undereducated, in prison, and unemployed at such high rates?
Like to say that so many black men are uneducated and in prison because it's a conspiracy. The white man wanted. They built more prisons. They should be building more colleges. My honest answer would be, reflecting on reminiscing of Malcolm X when he spoke about education. An inferior education will get you an inferior job. An inferior job will afford you an inferior pay. Inferior pay will only allow you to have inferior lifestyle, and it's a vicious cycle. This is what Malcolm said, so that plays a major role in why so many people are black young individuals are in prison, and uneducated, a lack of role models, the environment. We find ourselves being a product of the environment.
Education, further or higher education really wasn't on the list in my household, in my neighborhood. Like, for me to go to college, it was kind of like a flip of the, it was so lucky. It was a lucky break for me that a lot of people in my neighborhood didn't have. We're just not educated about it. We're just not taught within the home about the importance of education, because me coming up understanding knowledge is key. If we educate them and help them understand the importance of an education, how far an education could take them, I think we'll have more people trying to get in school and trying to do better with themselves versus taking that quick road to trying to be a a drug dealer or even a NBA star or some kind of sports or trying to do music or follow that life that everybody put before them on TV.
There are a lot of educated black men out here. It's just that maybe they just get comfortable of where they're at. They don't want to go further. You know, hey, I got my bachelor's degree. You know, I'm just gonna stop here and I'm gonna just work and I'm gonna stay complacent in where I am. I think that why that number is so large is because black women have a little bit, I guess you can say they have a little bit more fire inside of them to get it done and do it. They wanna succeed. Black men, they can get complacent and be like, well, all right, I made it. I'm gonna stop now. And, you know, they don't reach out for more, you know, get the master's, get the doctorate, being 10%, 15% on the boardroom, black men, they don't do that. It's either they don't care or they just don't want to do it. But I mean, the proof is in the pudding. You know, $50,000 higher than, you know, black women to black men is an extreme gap.
We're seeing the rise of people being bullied in school. We're seeing the rise of people that are being medicated. We're seeing the rise of depression. We're seeing the rise of more people come into a school and kill everybody. You know, those things never took place. And where is that coming from? I think it's coming from morals being broken down. I think it's coming from the acceptance of what we're showing on television, the acceptance of what we're hearing on the radio, the acceptance of what's influencing not only the children, but us as the parent. I think it's also increased because we have children raising children. Because of the absence of their parents were divorced, their parents were a single parent, their parents were raised where it was just them.
Educational system right now, people don't know about the No Child Left Behind Act. What that basically was they put these standardized tests out here. And based on if you pass a standardized test, that's the school system that gets funding. So the public schools aren't passing in the black neighborhoods, but the white schools keep passing, so that's where the government keeps putting the money. So let alone, we're not even getting the educational system to be able to teach our kids to go out in the workforce and get good jobs.
Because like I stated before, I've been locked up plenty of times, incarcerated for some things I did and some things I didn't, just being around the wrong people. So I don't want none of my kids to have to go through that.
The white girl I was dating at the time, we got into an argument. I ended up going to jail for assault on a female.
It's a lack of, resources, and that's nationally. That's just not locally. I think they should do more to, support these kids. I mean, the kids are the future. I mean, if they don't get educated properly, job training, I mean, what's going to happen?
My fiance actually works in the school system. And there's just, it's broken and needs to be fixed desperately.
Nowadays, to be in corporate America, you have to have even more than a high school education. You know, we're looking in the business, you're looking for a degree.
I think a lot of the problem these days is that everybody thinks that it's the public school system's responsibility to raise their children instead of their own.
Well, I work in an inner city school, and the thing that I notice is mainly the parent involvement. We miss a lot of the parent involvement. And the support at home, helping with homework, helping with any of their studies. They struggle. They're one of the lowest, when we do assessments, the African American population is actually one of the lowest because they're not getting the support at home. We're given as much support as we can at school, but then when they go home to practice all of that, a lot of, they're one of the lowest.
Growing up,
I didn't really have a lot of male role models. I mean, you have sports athletes that you see on TV and rappers. For instance, I guess the biggest like role model, well, black person, that male, that we probably could target and say that's a person that's making it happen in mainstream, like politics or whatever, maybe it was what, Jesse Jackson? Like when Jesse Jackson ran for president in 88, that's about the apex, I guess you could say, of somebody, you know, making it work on both ends of the spectrum. Now you have more people, and you even have a president who's black, that plays a major role. If I was 13 nowadays, watching something like that play out like it is now, who knows what I could have, you know, not that I haven't, you know, reached my goals, but, you know, things like that make a big impact on a child with no father or something like that. They, you know, they see, it's visceral. They see these things, and therefore they can see it's possible. Sometimes people have to see things are possible in order to do them.
African-American males are being slack, you know, and they're just thinking that everything is instant. I call a generation now these days the instant generation. They want instant success. I'm a physical education teacher at elementary school. Some of my kids really don't know what a stove is. Everything their mom cooks is in the microwave, so they're just about instant. Everything is done immediately. They don't know how it takes time for certain things to be done. So, you know, they're thinking that, okay, I'm gonna write a couple of rhymes. I'm gonna make that big rap career like a Soulja Boy. You know, I'm gonna go on YouTube and get found. Whereas they don't wanna buckle down and say, well, okay, I can do that on the side, but I still need to pursue an education. You know, they'll just drop everything. I think the reason being that so many males, African American males, are incarcerated is because I guess I can go back to the first question about, you know, substance abuse. You know, a lot of them are. I have several friends that are in prison, you know, doing time, and, you know, a lot of them that's there, I tell you that a lot of the guys are there because of drugs, you know, just being high that night or on something, and they do something for the first time, and, you know, and it's something that's very drastic.
Black men are in prison because ignorance, and they're trying to go for things that they don't have to go for. They're going for the wrong goals in life. Life is about, it's about having things, but they want the wrong things. It's about having a family. That's how I look at it. I love family. I'm a big person on family.
We're at a point where we weren't taught. Our generation, Generation Y, that's in the, you know, mid-20s, early 30s, we were raised by hip-hop. We were those 80s babies where crack took over. My father's a heroin addict, you know? I mean, I got cousins that's crackheads. So when you grow up in a one-parent household, if your mom got to work overtime, two jobs, you get raised by the streets. And we grew up on hip-hop, so now we're that generation teaching this next generation.
Money getting low, jobs laying off, a nation free, everything seems to cost. Cuz doing time, 20 more to go. 10 years done, that's what the hell I call. Grandpa's passed, auntie did too. Grandma never witnessed what a grandson could do. Got me spitting pain. I ain't lying, it's how the soul thing came. Martin had a dream, shit, me, I had a few of those. Let the cold sweats, grabbing bottles, popping two of those. You ain't never felt pain like this young dude. To the point your own life starting to haunt you.
Black women seem to rise high and make their way to the top of America's totem pole. She's becoming educated, adequate, and self-sufficient. As cultivated black women, it appears we have learned to shatter the glass ceilings that was once stationed high above our heads. Our radical determination has enabled us to skyrocket in corporate America. Women of color held 3% of the Fortune 500 board seats in 2010-2011. Are we really this driven to succeed, or are we overcompensating for the lack of compatible relationships?
In the past, it's always been that a woman had to be dependent on a man, that she could do nothing without getting her husband's approval. But I feel in these day and times, with so many women in such within high positions, that it shows that they necessarily did not have to depend on their male counterpart to get there.
You can find women everywhere in any different type of profession.
I mean, we got women as engineers, women as architects. I mean, some of the best. Women that design cars. So women can do anything that men can do. And like nowadays, they're showing that. They're proving that.
The majority of Black women are moving up the ladder of success because we have nowhere else to go. You know, we've been on the bottom for so long that I think we have this hunger to make things better for our children. So I do think that we're doing well right now.
Some look at Black women as being inferior, and that's not true. So the fact that we can prove ourselves and be independent and move up the ladder, it proves a lot and kind of shows people that we're not inferior in some of the ways that they think we are.
The increase in statistics for women getting bachelor's degrees and master's degrees, it's very encouraging. It makes me feel that we are rising above everything that's thrown at us and all the stereotypes. And my drive for education would be, I just personally want this. I don't want to live like how I see in some of the movies where Black girls are in the ghetto with 5 kids, no one else around, and I want to rise above it too. I want to be in those statistics where there's more women, Black women getting master's degrees and everything like that.
My mom and dad were married, and even after they divorced, my dad was still 110% in my life. You know, it wasn't, they separated and that was it, no father. I'm 27, and before I came into this interview, he called to check on me, see how I was doing. He's there. And I wasn't out in the street, so, you know, looking for love in the wrong places, basically. I knew I had love from both of my parents, whether they were together or not. And I feel like that's how I escaped it, because I look at some of my high school classmates and fathers aren't there. You know, they have 3 or 4 kids from, you know, however many baby fathers. And like I said, you know, it's a revolving door. But I feel as if that's how I escaped it. I had two parents that, you know, were there for me every step of the way.
With 70% of the women now, African-American women now, you know, going further in their education and higher education with masters and PhDs, I really think it plays a part because, you know, African-American males are not doing their part as far as, well, not doing their part, but I mean, a lot of them are incarcerated. I mean, a lot of them incarcerated, a lot of them strung out on drugs. So these positions that these women are getting are actually open positions, and women know that, African-American women know that they have children that they have to raise and they have to take care of themselves. So it goes back to me saying that they are go-getters. I mean, they are go-getters, so they know what they have to do to be able to get what they want. So they're going after these VP jobs, these CEO jobs, and they know that they have to get an education because they have to raise their kids.
Do I think Black women are loyal? Hell no.
I am a Black woman. I have a bachelor's degree in computer science from Florida A&M University.
My current position, I am a qualified professional within an intensive in-home, and I work with kids.
My master's degree is in healthcare administration. That's what I have my degree in.
I work for Bank of America.
I am a Black woman, and I have a master's degree in counseling.
My profession is a programmer or slash business analyst.
I graduated from South Carolina State University with a Bachelor of Science in Math, and also I double majored in Spanish.
I am a qualified professional with an intensive in-home, and I am a professional counselor.
I have a master's degree in business administration with an emphasis in management.
Okay, my profession. I'm currently employed with the South Carolina Department of Mental Health. I'm a program coordinator in the forensics division at that department. So that's what I'm doing right now.
I am a radio personality and I manage a radio station.
I have an executive graduate master's degree or certificate in accounting information.
because we're single, we're mothers, then guess what? We're the head of the household. We're not just the lioness anymore. We take on the lion and the lioness role. The disciplinary, the affectionate, we take on all of that. So by us having to wear that hat, then we come to an aggressive point in life where we say, you know, get or be gotten. And for some of us like me, I don't want to be gotten. I don't want to be that statistic that says I'm at the welfare line waiting for somebody to hand me something. I'm going to go out there and bust my ass open to take care of my kids, and I'm not going to be on the corner, and I'm not going to be on nobody's strip pole. I'm going to go out there and work, have a very good job, work 8 to 5, take care of my kids, and to look at my kids, you would not know that they came from a single parent home. So a lot of men find that women like me and my friends are very intimidated because they say, oh, you're aggressive. I don't know how to take you because you don't know how to submit to a man. You don't know how to be submissive. I don't mind being submissive when the right man is to be submitted to, but I'm not gonna submit to anything and anybody because that at that point, it allows me to open myself up in anything and anybody, so.
And I, as a black female, as what some would call successful, seeing as I've graduated college and have a master's degree and I finished that at the age of 23, I actually think we put a bit too much emphasis on female education and female empowerment right around the 60s or 70s when the women's lib was very big and, you know, very strong and, you know, I am woman, hear me roar and all of that anthem. That is when that change started to shift, and I think women liked seeing that, and women liked knowing their daughters could be just as successful as their sons, and then that's where a lot of that attention stopped being played to the sons so they could become the men to be in those positions. To me, Women's Lib is a celebration of women almost to the disregard of the man. As a woman of faith, we know women are already liberated in Christ, and the things that we see in scripture about women being taught, about women being leaders, about women being business leaders, even the Proverbs 31 woman, she was a business owner. It says she bought and sold. This is Old Testament. This is before Christ. She bought and sold. She saw a field. She bought it. She clothed her house. You know, she had talent. She had skills. She had a business. You know, she employed people. She had employees. You know, that's a powerful woman. And that's a woman in Christ. That's a biblical woman. The concept of a woman being strong or being a leader or being a business owner or being in royalty or leadership, that concept is not devoid in scripture. It's very much celebrated. But we don't see that. In the word, it's balanced that women aren't celebrated outside of men. You know, a woman being all of those things in the absence of the balance of that same celebration for a man. I think that what happened with Women's Lib a lot, marriage and family wasn't as celebrated as much. And so that wasn't no longer the highest call. It wasn't the holy mother anymore. It was the, no, I'm the mover, I'm the shaker, I'm driving that nice car, I'm in the country club, I'm at the board meeting, I'm the leader, I'm the president. Now it's not a chairman, it's a chairperson, or it's just the chair. So we have a gender neutral statement because it could be a woman.
Process of the African woman. Take the female and run a series of tests on her to see if she would submit to your desires willingly. Test her in every way because she's the most important factor for good economics. If she shows any sign of resistance in submitting completely to your will, do not hesitate to use the bullwhip on her to extract the last bit of bitch out of her. Take care not to kill her, for in doing so, you will spoil good economics.
Could this be real? Could all this be part of a master plan? I met with a close friend of mine, 2013 Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inductee, Professor Griff.
documentary, the name Willie E. Lynch continued to surface.
Mm-hmm.
Speak to us about him.
Well, it's often said by historians that the actual character Willie Lynch never existed.
Okay.
The actual documentation was never written by Willie Lynch. I contend that regardless of whether it was as factual, regardless whether it's authentic, according to those that those collectors of documents, is it real? Is the effect real? And you can look in society today, and you can go down and read the letter, and you can see whether or not if the effect of the letter is taking place in 2013, and it is. In all the areas of people activity, especially the few that I kind of dip and dab into, dealing with entertainment, sports, and education. It's very real. When you look at hip-hop, and you said it, you set the reality of hip-hop next to the Willie Lynch letter, the Willie Lynch letter jumps off the page. Aspects of it jumps off the page. One particular thing, if you can roll your mind back to 94, 95, where young people think hip-hop began. if you look at Biggie, Tupac, Eminem, during that era, how does the Willie Lynch letter, when you're looking through the lens of the Willie Lynch letter, when you're looking at the beef between East Coast and West Coast, that particular thing jumps right out of the Willie Lynch letter.
How? For those who are unfamiliar with it.
Okay, well, if people are unfamiliar with the whole idea of this aspect of the Willie Lynch letter, playing aspects of qualities that we have, but playing them against one another and using these kits and these tools, as mentioned in the Willie Lynch letter, to use them against us, to exacerbate the differences between us. When you start comparing the shorter with the taller, the lighter with the darker, the east versus the west, north, south, who lives up on the hill, who lives in the valley. So we can easily say, okay, the whole beef in hip hop, East Coast versus West Coast, came from the Willie Lynch letter. But listen to me, there was no difference. These were two talented brothers in hip hop. And when you talk about an East Coast, West Coast beef, so to speak, in hip hop, if you really look at Tupac's history, Tupac was mainly from the East, but ended up in the West. But that was by design, and then they used Tupac to play off against Biggie by saying Tupac was from the West and playing it off of Biggie. Now, how does that relate back to the Willie Lynch? In the Willie Lynch letter, it talks about they would play the North against the South. Who lives on the hill, who lives in the valley, East against West. And it's exactly what not only the media, but record companies and executives did inside of the context of hip hop. Right now, as we speak, there's an anonymous letter on the internet talking about how record executives got together in a private meeting, and they basically said that, but because we own shares and stock in Vivendi and all the major record companies and distribution companies, them same executives, these same people that was mentioned in this anonymous letter, also own private prisons. So what they did that day, at the end of that meeting, was came up with a plan to criminalize hip-hop, to niggerize hip-hop, to herd young black men and women into private prisons because they had to fill the prisons.
So Willie Lynch is the reason why so many black men are in prison and undereducated?
Oh, of course, because that's a system, it's a formula that was put in place. And they followed the formula to the T. Written in 1712, they said basically it would last 300 to 1,000 years. 2012 marked the 300th year of the Willie Lynch letter. You tell me if that stuff still's going on. Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Ray Charles and Stevie Wonder could see that. So look at the vast majority of women that are in education now, and look at the vast majority of the brothers that are still on the corner and in prison. 2 million people in prison in America. Brothers being locked away in the prime of their lives. And then you talk about the effeminization of the African male. Then you talk about brothers in prison, brothers on drugs, no men in the household, while women off in college getting degrees. That's by design, coming right from the Willie Lynch letter. Can't deny it, whether these people want to say it's authentic or not, hell, we feel the effects of it. And that's very real. And this is by design, just like the East Coast, West Coast beef in hip hop was trumped up and manufactured by using the media. The media standing, MEDIA stands for Multi-Ethnic Destruction in America, or Maniac European Devils in Action. They used the media to exacerbate the tensions when there really wasn't any tension between East Coast and West Coast. So was the beef actually real? No. Was it manufactured? Yes. But just like the Crips and the Bloods, the blue and the red, just like the Democrats and Republicans, do you understand what I'm saying? They use these differences to exacerbate the tension. And the Willie Lynch letter is still in effect. And we're losing Tupac, Biggie, Martin, Malcolm, and all those brothers that want to stand up and speak truth to power and can stand up. So if we were educated and knew the science behind the role of the media, and then we knew business, then we would understand the schemes and the machinations. But Elijah Muhammad said the three things that the white man would never teach us: the science of business, the science of warfare, and the science of mating.
What do you think black people are now with, as far as education wise?
Ooh, we on life support. What I mean by that is simply because I think we tend to think that simply because we've been educated by our oppressor, then we're educated. No, there's a concept which Amos Wilson gives us. It's called the constants. We constantly have these things in place that would make us seem like we're making progress, but it's almost like you're on a treadmill. You're moving, but you're not making progress. You're not moving forward. And we need to understand this simply because if we take the gains and some of the things that we've gained back, let's say 20 years ago, it seemed like we're repeating that particular history. If you roll your mind back, reflecting upon what's going on today, did we not have black mayors in every city? We still didn't make progress. Did we have a drug culture and a drug problem that we had to deal with? Yes, and then the issue, the war on drugs. Do we still have a drug problem? Yes. So it's a constant. Things have to remain the same in order to maintain this particular society in which we live in. We can't make progress. Black people have to be made dumb in order for this world to work.
Black people have to be made dumb in order for this world to
work. Of course, we can't be smart and intelligent in order for this world to work. Then we upset the balance. So we have to be given the illusion. So they give us an African-American president. It may seem like we're making progress, but we're not. So we can go back and look at all the studies in psychology, and we can see how they based their science and their psychology on the Willie Lynch letter. If you look at Skinner with the rat was put in a box, in a cage, in a maze, and it's rewarded and punished according to the behavior. Hell, you could name any black city. That's all it is. So they drop drugs, prostitution, strip clubs, negative music, bad education, religion, all this stuff into the box, and let's see how many of them make it out. And of course they handpick a few of them to make it out. You conduct yourself by these particular behaviors, we'll reward you, we'll give you a contract with the NBA. Now don't get out of line now. Or we'll give you a recording contract, Kanye West. Don't get out of line now. Don't say George Bush don't care about black people on national TV. Now we have to punish you. But you can have these set of behaviors and we'll reward you. So you keep exacerbating the gangster rap, the thugging, the pimping, the balling. Oh, yeah, we'll constantly reward you. Don't talk about anything positive. We don't want to hear nothing like them public enemy cats. Don't say anything positive. Now we have to punish you. We don't go too far. If I get on a plane and I'm going somewhere, I'm going to another hood. Do you understand what I'm saying? And let's define that. White people have communities, all right?
Yes.
Thriving communities. When I say thriving communities, banks, schools, hospitals, everything that they need. We live in hoods, neighborhoods inside of their communities. Are you following me? So that's Willie Lynch, front and center. The Skinner psychology, based on what Willie Lynch laid out in 1712.
Why do you think so many black women are single? Because according to statistics, 70% of African-American women are single, and of that 70%, 42% are unwed mothers.
Well, if you look back at the institution that they said that they wanted to destroy, and they have, if you read their history books, that institution was the family. And then we've been made, black women have been made to believe in being so independent that they can do it without a man while raising a boy into manhood. Impossible. Black women are the only women that say that. No other woman says that because other women understand family. And we've been made to think that family is just me, my homeboy, and my shorty. You understand what I'm saying? And my mom who raising us. No. We have to trick ourselves into thinking that, yes, we can have this family with any other race of people coming in to make up the family. Because that's a desire, a natural desire in the woman. She leans towards that. So if she's not looking towards the black man to complete the family, then the next man would have to do.
Do you think the way society is going that we will potentially end up in slavery again?
Well, hopefully we'll be able to avoid that. But when we talk in terms of slavery, I think the virtual chains are there. If you look at what the purpose of slavery and what they did and the methods that they used in slavery, we're not too far off. People are being controlled. People are already handcuffed. People are already acting as though in this physical slavery. Willie Lynch talks about how they would break the female. But how do they do that today? They do that by breaking the male and having the female present. And it even said in the letter that the roles would be reversed. And if the roles were reversed and the black male is being effeminized, mm-hmm. then the black woman would not look at the black man to be her mate or her protector. She would look towards the white man. And even another woman. Who's masculine. I'm made to look at as being something to fear because of the criminalization process, especially now in 2013. It's almost in the psyche. You could look at the recent murders of black men by cops. Trayvon Martin, for example. In that individual's psyche, it's already the fact that the black man's a threat. And Dr. Francis Cresswell's, and once again, her Neely Fuller lays it out. It has a lot to do with all the psychological damage that's been done to white people also. Everything from penis envy to the fact that, you know, we've been made to look at as just being brute beasts. You know, and it's very real.
It's very real.
Remember, the roles are reversed.
Right.
So we have to understand the psychological effect. And it's controlled. And it's funny that you should say that, because if you take one aspect of slavery and you look at it, did they hand out menus on the slavery plantation to figure out what we wanted to eat? No.
No.
Then what did the brothers and sisters eat during slavery? Basically the leftovers and what white people didn't want, right or wrong. You could go to any black neighborhood and you'll find the Safeway or the Giant store. I don't know what y'all have here, but they have a commercial in Atlanta where people are going Krogering. Not shopping, but Krogering at Kroger's. Are you following me? And it's only recent that you got the Whole Foods and the farmers markets and this kind of thing. We're not acclimated to that. We're acclimated to going to the corner store to get the worst food, all right? And the corner store is not controlled by us. So we really don't have that, we don't exercise that choice because we're not educated. We're not trained to do that because we have no land. It's like a cancer. And a lot of us foolish enough to believe that we can pass cancer from one generation to the next. No, you can't. That's not how you get cancer. Cancer comes from these learned behaviors. You can't pass it on from mother to daughter. So we need to understand these things so we can look at our living, which white people call your diet. We don't eat to die, you eat to live. So if we look at what we eat, now can you imagine you stopping at McDevil's and Murder King and Drunken Donuts and Toxic Hell and what's some of these other places, Kentucky Fried Chicken and some of these places that you stopping through and you stopping through at a window ordering the number 3 with extra cheese. Are you following me? But this is your diet now. With Tay-Tay in the back, strapped in the car seat, what do you think he's learning? And you looking over your shoulder because you don't want to cook now because you're this modern woman. And you're passing that down subconsciously to your child. 12 years later, he's 14, 15 with his homeboys. Where's he gonna go? To the same drive-thru window, you're gonna order number 5 with extra cheese. And he'll give you a little toy with it. Are you following me? And these are the things that we pass down subconsciously. And we need to be careful of these things. So the mutation continues on a subconscious level as long as we keep the Willie Lynch concept alive and we pass it on unknowingly. So when you talk about slavery, of course, think about all the things that happened in slavery. You had no control over your body during slavery. It says here, on page 16 in the Willie Lynch letter, the breaking of the African woman, where it talks about you would be made to train your offspring to be subservient to white people to the point where they would break the man in front of you. Now that was an ugly, ugly, ugly example and an ugly truth that they put in the Willie Lynch letter. But when you tell that story and you get black people to understand that this is what went on and this is exactly what's going on today, how they would take the black man and tie his arms up to 2 horses and smack the horses on the ass and they would go in opposite directions and tear the brother apart in front of the black pregnant woman and instilling fear in the children and the woman. By the time she come up out of that experience, she'll no longer look to the black man for protection. And that's exactly what's going on today. This is why you find interracial marriages and couples. So what did it do to the black woman? Just look at the black woman. They took a black woman 8-9 months pregnant. Now, I don't know if too many people know this about history because these are hidden aspects of history. They would dig a hole. So your beautiful belly, which in houses and cases, your beautiful baby to fit in. And they would lay you down and strap you down to the ground and beat you to an inch of your life simply because they didn't want to kill you or kill the baby. But a black woman had to carry and pick at least a bale of cotton. Now, I don't know if you've ever experienced lifting a bale of cotton or 5 bales of cotton a day. This was very, very real during this particular period. But they built these holes to put the pregnant woman's belly in, and they would still whip and beat the woman to instill fear in the children. Can you imagine 400 years of that? Now, how will we be affected by that today? Please tell me if I'm incorrect on this particular point. The average black woman, especially on these black single websites and conversations on the internet, they want a man that's God-fearing. Where did this language come from? Why should we even want to fear God? Now don't get it twisted with the natural fear.
Right.
Okay. But the average black woman want a God theory, man. We shouldn't want to fear the Creator, but that's a carryover of the Willie Lynch, simply because the fear has been put in the black man and in the black woman and in the children. So now the black woman don't look to the black man, she looks to the white man. What is wrong with that? Drum roll, please. Here comes the white Jesus. So now with the psychological effects of slavery coming up out of that with Willie Lynch chip still in us. You damn right you're gonna see the churches filled with black women only. The majority of the churches, these mega churches, are filled with black women calling on the white Jesus because it's out of fear. It's out of fear. We've been sold down the river if we pray to any of the Orishas. Ptah, Allah, Jah, Ra, any of the gods that we knew. Any of the 400 Orishas that we used to call on in the Yoruba or the Ifa tradition. So we couldn't call, we couldn't practice our natural spiritual concepts. So they beat it into us, beat it out of us, and they beat into us the white Jesus. That if we called on any other God, we'd get whipped, castrated, burned, lynched, or sold down the river. You damn right, I called Jesus too after 400 years of that. Are you following me? But here we are in 2013, and you try to put this in front of a black woman and say, listen, this is the reason why we do this, out of fear on a subconscious, psychological level. You can't tell them nothing. Jesus is their Lord and Savior. Stop that. Stop. You could look at society today, and we're being controlled, basically. The example I often give audiences, what better way to control people by controlling one cat like Jay-Z? If we can control him, then we control the millions of people that look up and respect and honor and think Jay-Z's an icon. So we don't have to worry about the million people. We'll just control him. We'll give him some money, give him a deal, 360 deal, make him popular, give him videos, give him music, give him songs, name a sneaker after him, and we're fine. We ain't got to worry about them. And that's what they're doing with the President of the United States, your friend, Barack Obama. I see something very critical happening in America. Barack Obama signed off on the gay agenda, brought Jay-Z in. He's making commercials and speaking very highly of same-sex marriages and this kind of thing. Who the hell is stopping and say, wait, pump the brakes? Who's having a conversation with Tay-Tay and Riri and them? And Man-Man and Junior and Day-Day? Who's having a conversation with them so they can understand what's going on? Absolutely no one. And they're sitting back viewing this through a narrow, distorted lens, fed to them by MTV and BET. No one's having the conversation. At least let us have the conversation with them to at least educate them to the degree where they can at least make an intelligent, spirited choice. Are you following me? That is very, very, very real. No one's having a conversation. No one's having a conversation about the things you and I are talking about. Where are those classes that were set up post-slavery to teach us how to undo this Willie Lynch chip that's affecting all of our lives? We suffered from this post-traumatic slavery syndrome. We don't know what happened to us. We don't know the reason why we can't even get along. Black men, black women at odds with one another. I can't get along with my grandfather. Grandpa can't get along with my children. These dynamics are going on. No one is having the conversation. We just going along and act like it's gonna work itself out. Hell nah. There's a smelly, white, fat elephant in the living room, and everybody, every morning, walks right past the damn elephant, and no one says anything like it's gonna take care of itself. No, it's not gonna take care of itself. We have to begin to at least be bold enough, like you guys are doing, by having a damn conversation, and be bold enough to speak up and stand up and talk. Me and my crew, we said the hell with it. We gonna go to the drug traps. We gonna go in the hood, and ain't none of the homeboys gonna be able to hide from us. Because we're going to have that conversation wherever they want to have the conversation. Plain and simple. Be it in the drug trap, street corner, or wherever they want to have the conversation. Sad part about it, we can't get the pastor, the preacher, and the damn school teacher to have the conversation. Because they have something to protect. Which is sad. Really sad. So we're going to lose. Collateral damage. Millions of black people we're going to lose.
In today's generation, we don't typically read. We can Google everything. Mm-hmm. So how do we deliver this message to let them know that this is happening and that we need to change?
We have to start now educating and training a generation that's gonna come up and stand strong and speak truth to power. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for our open enemy to teach our children to take their place? That's not gonna happen. No people in power are gonna educate someone that's weaker than them to take their place. That's just impossible. It's just not gonna happen. And we'd be foolish enough to think that it is going to happen. It's foolish. So we need to understand we have to start someplace. And what better place to start than in the home? The education starts in the home anyway. We must begin to at least be bold enough to have the conversation. Even if we just talk about just getting back our culture getting back with your culture, which is your way of life, getting back your history. You can ask the average black person in America, where did the history begin? For the average black person, black history starts at slavery. So anything, one iota past, any accomplishment, one iota past slavery would seem like a great accomplishment. Then we become the first one to do this, the first one to do that, and the first one to accomplish that, when we've already did these things. But if we rolled our minds and our spirit back past 1555 onto the African continent, we had a great, rich, rich, valuable history. There's nothing new under the sun. That's where that saying comes from. So we were the first architects. We were the first astronomers. We were the first writers. We were the first scientists. We navigated and circumvented and navigated the globe several times. So we've been there before. Hopefully we can put some things in place that will offset what's going on with the psychological effects. Matter of fact, the physical effects of the Willie Lynch letter. I know some people have wrote it off. It's not authentic, therefore it's not real. Guess what? They said the AIDS virus was made in a laboratory in Fort Detrick, Maryland. Are people dying from AIDS? Thank you. So do we, the fictitious story or however they came up, you can believe it if you want to believe it. But nonetheless, real people are dying from a real disease, right or wrong. Once again, as I always say, after I leave every interview and every talk, revolution is not an event, it's a process.
You know, it makes me feel bad that our family structure has been destroyed the way it has. And a lot of black men need to realize that a black woman's her sense of independency and wanting to be so strong, that came out of wanting to protect our families and protect our boys. You know, we saw them beat and pulled apart by horses, and who wants that for their child, you know? So as misguided as our aggression and our overpowering can be, it still comes from a place of love, you know? And I think the best way for us to get out of this, we're gonna have to love each other out of it.
They ripped everything we have from us, everything we know. Think of everybody, think of the US, right? Everybody always comes over here, Puerto Ricans, most very proud of their culture. Indians, proud of their culture. Black people, we got hip hop. That's our culture. That's what we know. As a USA, as an African American, Brian Ellison, my culture is hip hop. That's what we know. That's what we know from the USA. That's what I feel like. That's what I grew up in. That's my era. But I don't know nothing. You ask me where I'm from in Africa, I don't know. We don't know nothing. We've been stripped of everything. We've been lost.
It's a program, but it's your part to either follow that program or not follow that program.
Living off the system is just a revolving door. And until we fix that problem, everything else is just, it's gonna continue.
Society or the system or the government, whoever you want to blame, is going to keep the black man at bay and continue to allow the female to be prosperous so that we will not come together, we will not stand together, and we remain, you know, as men, less.
Repetition deepens the impression, so it's a number of actions, a number of words that, you know, that follow with that, you know, that effect that you're not realizing what you're doing. You're not realizing the negativity that, you know, comes from your words, comes from your actions, comes from just the way you carry yourself, you know? So it's be accountable with the way you dress, the way you speak, the way you act, and, you know, how you treat others.
This film came about after having conversations with different people of different gender. I went to an HBCU, South Carolina State University, is where I graduated from. There I met and encountered many different people, white, black, Hispanic, it didn't matter, they all went there. Several black men that I knew that attended that university told me on multiple occasions that they didn't like black women. Black women were evil, disrespectful.
They couldn't wait to marry outside their race because it makes them feel better. It gives them empowerment. A friend of mine in college once told me that she couldn't stand African-American men who choose not to date their race and had a race preference. I was completely naive and ignorant to the fact that young men and women thought this way about their own race. Ran across a good friend of mine named Travis. Travis said some very hurtful things to me, but it wasn't about me. He would make it very known that he couldn't wait to marry a white girl with a rich daddy. And I couldn't think how a man who speaks so highly of his black daughter thought so poorly of black women. Had another friend named Vince Jacobs. Vince told me black women were at the bottom of the barrel. I think that was the most hurtful comment I have ever heard someone actually say about black women. Because me being his friend and him telling me that, again, he wasn't talking about me. He was talking about a gender as a whole. But the fact still remains that I'm part of that gender. And for him to think that it's perfectly fine for black women to be viewed as the bottom of the barrel, that baffles me. To this day, it baffles me because I just don't understand, especially when you were raised in a two-parent household. Parents were married for over 20-plus years, and you went off to a prestigious school to do great things. You were taught better than that. You saw that mother in that household. You saw that submissive wife. You saw your father and your mother together. You had that unity that most people yearn for. But for you to think that still, after all this time, we're the bottom of the barrel when you personally know differently, something is really wrong with that picture. One day on Facebook, I get on Facebook and I actually see a status. The status read, "This is a white woman's world. When are you black women are gonna realize you're just living in it?" Strike three. I mean, really. As a black man, you shouldn't have any nerve putting a status like that up on Facebook. But it wasn't what he said. It was the fact that he had thousands of likes on this one status. So that immediately said to me that it wasn't him who thought that way. Multiple men thought that way also. So where do we go wrong here? Which is how the film came about. I wanted to seek to understand from different men and women from different age groups to actually understand exactly the perception that young African Americans have today, and as well as where have we gone wrong. In order for us to create a plan of action to move forward, we must identify the problem. And honestly, I didn't even know it at first, but now I do.
You know, you talk about social media and how it's taking over our lives, and how even something as simple as Facebook becomes a credible news source.
At 11:30, after the news went off, 11:45, TV signing off with the dun, 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 dun. I mean, no more television. Now television is 24 hours. They have access to television 24 hours. Television, you got Twitter, you got Instagram, you got Facebook, all of these social networks.
Exploiting women, prostitution. And when you turn on the TV nowadays, that's all you see. You can't even watch a Disney Channel without some kind of boyfriend, girlfriend scene. This is Disney, Nickelodeon, but this is what we got our kids watching.
Everybody finds a way to desensitize what's going on with the music. But if you really sat and listened to some of the lyrics, girls kissing girls and, you know, suck my private part.
Another concern of mine is the black women being bashed for reality TV. We have so many people out there bashing, saying that, you know, reality TV give black women a bad name. If you want to talk about it, let's discuss it. It seems that African-American people, well, men, praise white women for stuff that they will call black females ratchet for. Perfect example, Miley Cyrus. This 20-year-old female stood on stage disrespecting a woman's husband, a woman and her husband, a marriage pretty much, twerking, doing all of this, looking like a straight prostitute, and she's 20 years old. Granted, she is an adult. She can do what she pleases. But at the same time, if that was a black woman on camera, on stage like that, with those clothes and licking out her tongue and touching someone's crotch,
Oh, that would have been the number one topic. That would have been, they would have been talking about how undereducated black people are and how we as a whole need to, you know, how that black woman needed her father because she didn't have anyone there to teach her any guidance, but yet they're praising her. There's not one reality TV show that doesn't give the other a bad name. You have Housewives of Atlanta. Yeah, that's a black TV show. Because we have high ratings, it's negative. But let's put the term down also. You have Housewives of Orange County, New York, New Jersey, Washington, Miami, and they're all white cast. They're doing the same thing. They're fighting. They're being disrespectful. They're using profanity. So what difference are they with the black show and the whites? Is it because the black show gets more TV ratings that it becomes an issue? For every love and hip hop, you have a different show. You have what? Real World. You have Jersey Shores. They're acting crazy the same exact way. What about mob wives? Let's break that term down. What's a mob? People that steal, kill, felons or whatever. So you have a TV show, white TV show, predominantly white TV show, who husbands are in prison serving time or have been in prison, who are voicing this on national TV for money they stolen, for money laundry, for drugs, for all of this. But they're fighting also. Those are real thugs. They're not doing the pick and nitpicking arguments as you see on Housewives of Atlanta or Love and Hip Hop. They're getting physical. They're blacking eyes. Them the real thugs. But let's just reverse that for a second. Let's make that cast all black. And these baby mamas taking their kids to see their baby daddies in jail. But in that situation, of course, we wouldn't use mob. They'll probably say, you know, street farmers' wives or something like that, because you'll try to make it to belittle the black woman again. Okay, but let's just say something like that. Drug dealers' girlfriends. What's the difference? It's no difference. If a black woman was taking her kids to see her baby daddy in prison, that would be the number one talk show. Again, it would be the number one talk show talking about how black women don't have the guidance they need, undereducated, why they're this, why they're that. What's the difference? And my thing about it is, African-American men make so much, you make such a big thing out of hair weaves, but my thing about it is, it's no different than you guys expressing yourselves in other ways. You guys putting 24s or 22s on a Buick or an old car just to stand out. Why do you do it? And if that's the reason why you guys choose to go out there and get white women, go ahead. They wear it too, but understand that. Those Kardashians, they wear it too. Coco, she wears it too. They're comfortable with who they are, because without the hair extensions, they're still the same person.
We educate the kids and we show them the application of knowledge. You know, not just get them information, but show them how to apply that information, how to apply themselves and be successful in society.
Visualize everyone, you know, like if that was my mother, would I treat her like that? You know, if that was my grandfather, would I treat him like that? You know, how would it feel if the shoe, you know, was on the other foot?
And just looking like Michael Jackson said it best, I'm starting with the man in the mirror. You know, we just have to make a decision that I'm more than my circumstances. You know, I had to do it. I had to look in the mirror and say, I'm more than the poverty that I come from. I'm more than the fact that my dad walked away, that he wasn't there. You know, I'm more than the fact that I wore hand-me-downs. Because I work hard, I can wear whatever I want to now. And we just have to know that, you know, it's not over. You know, we live to fight another day.
I had to come to learn that. I had to learn to accept myself. And in that, I made a roadmap for myself that I am the greatest I am that I want to be. Make up in your mind. You have to be focused. You have to be consistent. And you have to have courage. I'll tell you this. Courage is the ability to go from failure to failure and not lose your enthusiasm. I don't care how many times you fall. I don't care how many times you messed up. You have to say, I have the courage to get up again.
For the 15-year-old Jamal Washington out there, I would like to say, listen to your teachers, to your pastor, to your parents. It's very important to listen to your elders. They're only out there to give you guidance and support. And also, be very independent and try not to always follow a crowd. Be yourself.
No matter your situation, you always, you know, you fight, you don't tell, never let a person tell you no, you can't do anything.
Black men, brothers, you are powerful, you are strong, you are kings. You should act as such. Be the head of the household, take back what was taken from you, and just be the man, be a man. Stop being or looking for support. Be strong, be that father figure, be that role model, be everything that we need you to be.
To the youth that's listening, stay focused. No excuses, no explanation. Just do what you're told, respect your elders, and stop crying, stop complaining. You haven't worked here long enough, you haven't worked hard enough, and stop trying to be an adult. You got all your life to be an adult. Be a kid, be respectful, and just do as you're told. You know, you're not the first to go through the situation you're going through.
Change always begins with one. If we as individuals just decide, I want to be a better person, I want to be a good father, I want to be a good mother, you know, I want to love my children, they didn't ask to be here. You know, I want to help my brother and sister out, even if they aren't my blood family.
A few years ago, I actually was pregnant from someone outside of my race. He was a white male, and many people had an issue with it. I do find it a bit odd and find that there's a disconnect for anyone who doesn't want to date someone within their race. There's an epidemic of African-American men who dates outside their race once they reach a certain status, such as NFL player, NBA player. Once they reach that level of fame, it's like, oh, the black community is no longer good enough for you. Black women, we aren't innocent by any means. There's a lot more that we can do to actually, you know, stop people from looking at us a certain type of way and have them to talk down on us. Perfect example, let's start with the main thing, these ghetto-ass baby names. There's no need, if you have to actually sound out your child's name, there's a problem. Maybe that child should not be named that. If you have to add a hyphen or apostrophe, That's kind of a problem. Let's think more about their future. Would you hire Jaquisha? Would you hire Janiyah? Would you hire Shekana? What we're trying to do is simply promote awareness, not to bash the black man, not to bash the black woman, not to bring anyone down, not to pinpoint or make anyone feel guilty for dating outside of their race. We don't care about that. We simply want to promote awareness. One thing that me and my counterparts have put together is that we actually come up with a foundation. The foundation is Build Break Build Exposure Academy. The foundation is actually set into place for those who are raised in a single parent home, even if you're raised with two parents, mother and father. It's as a mentoring, as a guidance. Just because you don't have that mother or father within that household giving you the guidance that you need, because he or she may be working or may be working two or three jobs, providing for you, the sole provider in the home, you have someone to talk to. We're gonna do mentoring groups. We're gonna do culture change. We're gonna learn different languages. We're gonna do financial savings plans. So therefore, there's no book to actually teach any of us how to be a man or a woman. Most of us learned from our parents, and most of them were kids raising kids. We're gonna teach you the difference between acting crazy in public and presenting yourself in a way to be taken seriously. That's what we're going to do. We're going to challenge you in many different ways. We're going to challenge you education-wise. We're going to ask you what it is you want to be. Let's work together. Let's pull together, because the only way that we're going to help our community or change the system is if we change ourselves. Simple as that. We can't expect for anyone to give us anything, because obviously it's not going to happen. But why not work together? Instead of pulling each other down, why not pull each other up and give everyone a helping hand?
I just want us to try. You know, it's so easy to get caught up in the ways of the world and to conform to the negativity that's around you. You know, I want people to try to love each other, try to take care of each other. You know, check on the older person that's around you. Check on, call your family, you know, smile at somebody. I always like to compliment people. If you see someone and they're pretty or they have on a nice shirt, guy, you know, man or woman, tell them. Because that, you never know what space that person is in. You know, they could be feeling, having the worst day ever, and you saying that makes their day better. And just smile. I don't think, even with all that we have going on, no one can take our smile. No one can steal your joy. So that's what I would say.
I think it's gonna have to start, like, it's gonna have to start within families. You know what I'm saying? Like, the morals and values and stuff that you instill in your child. It's gonna have to start there, you know?
My book is called Daddy Duty. How to build an unbreakable bond with your daughter, maintain it and restore it. It's an awesome book. I have a biased opinion though. I think what my book is centered around is six different duties. When we talk about balance and we talk about how hard it is to balance different things, it's important that we understand what we have to balance. My book focuses on six different duties. Protect and provide, invest quality time, discipline appropriately, connect emotionally, mentorship, and lead by example. I feel like sometimes fathers specifically will find themselves in an area of life where they're really concentrating on discipline, and we're naturally good disciplinarians, but we fail to connect emotionally. Or sometimes we can be the best protector and provider, but we can't keep food on the table. In each of those scenarios, a child is getting something that they need, but they're lacking something else. The best way I feel that we can raise a child is if we find a balance, a medium between each of those six duties. My book focuses on what those duties are and how we can apply each of those duties to the different stages in a young girl's life, from adolescence all the way to womanhood.
We change it. You know, how do we solve it? We change it. We show them something different. We start being different. We gotta make a change. You know, otherwise, we, Willie E. Lynch, we're enslaving ourselves. And we're enslaving our kids.
Black men, you are strong. You are the fathers. You are the kings. No matter how less worthy society tries to view you, you know who you are. I want to challenge you to be the men you're supposed to be and not the boys society wants you to be.
I am a black man.
My name is Tassie Cunningham. I am a black woman.
I am a black woman.
I am a black man. I am DeAndre Etheridge.
My name is Derek Omar Brown. I am a black man.
My name is Devon Reese. I am a black man.
I am Joshua McClellan. I am a black man.
I am a black man.
My name is Jason Perry, and I'm a black man.
My name is Lawrence Taylor. I'm a black man.
I'm Robert Jenkins, and I am a black man.
My name is Shante Evans. I am a black man.
I am a black woman.
I am LaPortia Chisholm. I am a black woman.
I am a black woman. I'm Shalonda Gallman, and I am good enough.
The loss, then I came back. Looked her in her eyes, then I back. So rap, I'm back, but this love is so intact. So addicted to the sound, like a fiend for that smack. One hit, she told me get it, like I'm so sad to bat. Don't knock it out the park, just make sure it's from their heart. Every soul and every mind, when they get it, they'll upstart. You the voice, you the hope, when it seems so hard. And all your pain can be their pleasure, bring them all up out the dark. Yes, I'm your life, so let me live, don't depart. And we gon' make history, no misery involved. And everything around us shall grow and evolve. So it's time to move forward and let the BSDs off. Keep them first, stay sane, and remember that we are. A picture painted perfect, so yes, We are Van Gogh with the flow, we just paint them and retards. Yeah. I'm a winner, back against the wall, that's the norm for a nigga. Still I go hard, I'm a born bread getter. Been knocked down, but I'm back like getter. Heart full of pain, tryna match it with my game. I do it for my folks, that's what keep a nigga sane. Tryna give them hope, ain't no reason for the change. A blind man can see, we the reason for our pain. And they ain't pointing fingers, yeah, they got us in the trap. Know how to play the game, so I play them right back. I came a long ways, tryna redefine black. Understand when you see me, yeah, I'm way beyond rap, nigga.
Keep your head to the sky. Feel me? Pop told us keep our head up. So my feet on the ground and my head to the sky, looking straight to the clouds. Scream to mama, I done made it through my trials. Say to say I'm blessed, got it tatted on my arm. Cause what I went through was like a stab to the heart. It showed I was strong, separated from others, able to move on. Cause my niggas and my brothers, when shit hit the fan, you really see true colors. And quick to find out who hates you and who love you. I call this life football, they own you when you touch them. With two hands up, reaching out for a buck. Can't forget how it started. I started out from the bottom, so everybody that doubted, I leave them dearly departed. This a letter to my fans and ones who thought I couldn't. Sincerely and truly yours, I love you. Be bullet.